This is the DLR Cast, the essential podcast for fans of Diamond David Lee Roth.
All right, what's happening? Welcome once again to the DLR Cast, the podcast by and for fans of Diamond David Lee Roth. As always, I'm Steve, along with my good friend, the ever wonderful Mr. Darren Paltrowitz. What's happening, Darren?
It is a nonstop Friday, but it is a good Friday. It's a great Friday. It's just a lot of greatness going around. Same by you?
Same here, man. And before we dig into this week's episode, speaking of great, we want to give a big thank you and hello to a slew of new subscribers and listeners, downloaders, streamers, the whole bit, who have discovered us. We'll just give a big thank you as well to the Van Halen News Desk that ran a great story on your terrific interview the last two episodes prior to this with Frank Meyer. We made some news.
We made some news there, and then that got picked up by Ultimate Classic Rock, Matthew over there, who we like a lot. And it's one of those things where you go, well, how do we get this great interview with Frank? One of our listeners said, you should interview Frank. So, hey, if you guys have any ideas for movies that might make a couple $100 million, you know, we're up for it. So, keep them coming.
Exactly. So, yeah, so a big thank you out to those folks over at Ultimate Classic Rock and the Van Halen News Desk. Just great folks all around. And, of course, if you go back a couple episodes as well, you'll see one of our two episodes with Eric Senich from the Van Halen News Desk, too. So, two websites that we really enjoy a lot, and it was great to see those stories. And I learned a couple other things as well. I think it was, some of the stuff that Frank talked about was referenced in various places, various points, but not in as much detail, but were talked about. There was chatter on some of that stuff. We won't give it away if you haven't heard it already and you got those episodes bookmarked and you plan on going back to listen to them. But some of that news that Frank was talking about that got in the news for us was that some of that was out in different places in different formats, but Frank really got into some detail about what he heard and saw and got involved with. So it was super cool, man, and it was a laugh riot for me just to hear it as a fan. So great job, and thank you.
Well, yeah, and it was also great to get some good stories about the Zappa family and Sam Kinison and I guess what it was like growing up in the late 80s in Los Angeles. And the stuff that he did with Dave was starting in the mid-90s and continued into the early 2000s. So it's not like Frank just had one time meeting David Lee Roth and one interaction related to people who played with David Lee Roth. These are stories in the 80s, 90s, and 2000s. So it's really spread out over time and interesting to hear Diamond Dave's evolution.
Exactly. And anyone who's got a story that has a scene where you're close to throwing up in Dave's bathroom because you're so hammered. Well, that's a story I want to hear.
And getting arrested or at least taken downtown after a David Lee Roth show and experiencing Club Dave. Hey, Frank is in rare company and hope we didn't cost him work. It's a great story you told us.
All right. Well, so speaking of listeners who reach out to us with a great story, that's how you got this guest.
Yes. Yeah, Steve Herold is one of the first people to write to us, maybe the first, and kept in touch because he would send us links along with, hey, great episode. Have you seen this? And Steve knows his stuff. So a couple episodes ago, we were talking about the Crazy from the Heat script. And I think I out of nowhere said to you, like, have you ever seen the script? What was it about? And we had a couple different listeners write and go, well, here's the script. Everyone has it. Duh. And you're like, oh, I guess we're the only people who never read it. So Steve Herold turned out to have read it, to not only have purchased it in the 90s and read it then, but he reread it for us and told us about this. But Steve, in his own right, an award-winning filmmaker, his work has been seen in over 75 film festivals worldwide. I liked a film that he did, I think about 2-3 years ago he made it, but it came up on Amazon more recently called The Umbrella Salesman. Funny guy, great filmmaker.
Yeah, and great guy to have a conversation with, too. It was a hell of a lot of fun, and I learned an awful lot about, when you think of it, a portion of Dave's career that, at least the last 30 years has been somewhat – I think somewhat forgotten about, kind of a footnote. I mean, it had a big part of why he left, you know, it was a big part of why he left Van Halen, or was pushed, depending on your perspective. And, you know, and maybe it's, maybe Dave wants it that way, that it is forgotten about. But again, I mean, it's a portion that was, I think, will be new news and be a lot of cool info for a lot of fans.
And relate to what we were talking about at the top with people talking about our stuff. Do you ever check out the Roth Army message board? I'm putting in you on the spot here.
I have. It's fun. It's a lot of fun most of the time. I haven't been on there in a few weeks, maybe actually more than a month, I don't think. But I mean, I think they were really in that space pretty early, if I remember. And there's always something interesting up there.
There was a little bit of, how do I put it? I'm a little obsessed with this post that went up in 2010 that I just discovered the other day, that this guy was talking about. He was at some kind of a dog related event in his town, and he heard a guy speaking, and he goes, "That's David Lee Roth. Why would he be here?" And he approached him and went, "Hey, are you Dave?" He's like, "Yeah." And he goes, "David Lee Roth? Yeah." It got a photo with him, and you see this photo of Diamond Dave from 2010, and he has a goatee. So then I have a theory on a theory here. When he doesn't want to be seen, is that facial hair time? Because if you visualize David Lee Roth in your head, you would think of a clean-shaven guy. Like, in other words, you'd never do a double take at him if he has a goatee and go, "Is that David Lee Roth?" You just go like, "That's not David Lee Roth. He doesn't have facial hair."
Yeah, that's the thing too. I bet you, I'm sure that's just one way you can kind of go incognito. That and perhaps an Iron Man mask. I'm not sure. So, but you know, if you go into the Roth Army forums, someone there posted episode 36 and 37 with Frank Myers. Thank you very much, Roth Army, fan forum folks.
Yeah, good people doing good things. And if any of them are listening to us and going, "How did you guys never do an episode about blank? Why haven't you spoken to this guy?" Yeah, when we were talking about talking with Steve Herold, he mentioned a third screenwriter on this film. So I sent a reach out email to him to get him on the show. I don't know if it's going to happen or not, but there might be people hidden in plain sight that have never spoken about Dave publicly. So we will continue on our quest to unearth them all.
Yeah, you know what it kind of reminds me of real quick? And this is just a kind of a weird analogy how my brain thinks. But remember Us Magazine? Where if I'm sure it's still out there, where I think there was that page in the back where it's like, "They're just like," I think it was Us Magazine, where they're just like us. And you would see a picture of Brad Pitt, you know, walk through a parking lot or whatever, holding a backpack, anything like that. And it always kind of reminds me, it's like, yeah, everybody's got regular, normal lives. And it kind of reminds me, I can't remember where this was, and this is something I would never, ever do, but years ago, I remember seeing a picture online on some blog a long time ago, and it was Dave tucking into a sandwich at like a food court or something. And it looked like him, a hat and a jacket. And the person who posted it was like really sure about it. And of course, there was a bunch of comments on there and everything. But it's just, you know, that kind of weird voyeurism. Yeah. You don't like to admit that you're curious or interested in. But I mean, they're just like us, truthfully, except for 100 other reasons why they're not.
Yeah. Well, making this the Darren Talks About Himself hour here. Yesterday, I taped an interview with Mark Cantor. He grew up with Slash from Guns N' Roses, and Cantor's Deli in L.A., the famous great deli restaurant that's still there all these years later. I was speaking to him about his new podcast, which is about the early days of GNR. And I was getting ready to grill him about all these David Lee Roth things. And then I read the vibes and went, okay, I'll stop after these two questions there. But there was an old story about Diamond Dave giving the career advice breakdown. I'm like, this is what you do with your career thing, to Vince Neil in the early days of Motley Crue. He did it at Cantor's Deli. And so I said, "So is it true about blank, blank, blank?" He goes, "Oh yeah, I've seen Dave like 100 times at Cantor's Deli, usually eating alone." So like, oh, okay. He's one of those guys that can dine alone. I think Fred Stoller used to have a blog about dining alone and the best places to dine alone at.
Oh, man. Yeah, I mean, listen, you got to eat, right? This week's interview is awesome with Steve Herold. And once again, we want to say thank you for downloading and streaming and digging the DLR cast.
Yeah, nothing but yeah, as DLR would say, and nothing but Steve, as I would say, maybe. Well, whatever it is. No, thank you for listening. Steve Herold, you are a delight to speak with. And if you've got ideas about things that we should be doing or talking about, or things we're totally wrong about, such as Steve Herold calling out Steve Roth about no big ting, shadowing right here, please give it to us. And thank you for listening.
Yeah, shoot us, reach out to us, hit us on Twitter or the, hit us on Twitter and, or email us directly at, and actually on Twitter, it's at DLR Cast, and then hit us directly at the DLR Cast at outlook.com.
Thank you. It is an honor and a pleasure to be connecting with Mr. Steve Herold, who is maybe the first person to ever write us an email giving us kudos for this podcast. So I think he's won the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory equivalent of being a guest on this podcast. But in all seriousness, Steve has given us a lot of intel, which I've used for some of the interviews that we've done. So, Steve, thank you for being on the show. Great to have you.
Thanks. Great to be here. You forgot to mention that I was the first and only person who's ever written to you guys.
not the only, but we can maybe say the most frequent. So,
yeah. But you are, as we talked about in the intro, a filmmaker. What's the latest project that you are promoting or show or production, or are we separating that from the DLR fandom?
We can kind of separate. I mean, I work in TV. I freelance in TV mostly. I just got back from, I had a run of gigs. I'm like on a crew, nothing to, you know, brag about. It's just, you know, freelance TV work. I just got back from a couple of months in Louisiana, Cape Cod, Pennsylvania. I travel a lot for the gigs that I'm on. I'm actually in August heading up to Canada to work on a survival show, and we'll be up there for a little while. But myself, I'm an indie filmmaker myself. I'm just started shooting a new short film, something, you know, to try to kind of deal. We started working on it with the pandemic, trying to, you know, figure out a way to make an independent film, you know, under those sort of stipulations. So that's mainly what I'm working on now. Yeah.
Does that indie film involve Yakuza and a Japanese-speaking David Lee Roth?
Of course it does. I didn't even think I needed to mention that.
Well, as a film guy, Steve and I have referenced Crazy from the Heat, the ill-fated screenplay written by Mr. Roth in the early 80s that was slated to be made in 1985 or so. But we thought about it, and we never read it. So I said, wait, who might have read this? And the answer is, You have read the screenplay. I think you said that you read it for the first time in the early 2000s.
No, I bought this in a shop in Hollywood in 1990. You know, as you know, I write, and when you're starting out trying to learn screenwriting, a lot of times what you do is you read screenplays. So I'd go to the shops in Hollywood, and you could buy copies of the screenplays. So I was in there, and you know, just looking over what they had, and this is 1990, and you know, I was shocked to see a title in their list say Crazy from the Heat. And I remember asking the guy, like, is that the David Lee Roth script? You know, and the guy's like, well, let's take a look, you know, and he pulled it off the shelf. And sure enough, it was. And so I bought it and I read it in 1990. And 1990 Steve number two probably thought it was hysterical. But I hadn't read it since. So, you know, when we discuss this, I read it for the first time since 1990. And it wasn't as bad as, I mean, we're going to get into it, but it wasn't as bad as I expected it to be. Like, our good friend Greg Renoff, I remember passing him a copy of this off to him and saying, like, yeah, Dave really dodged a bullet when this movie didn't get made, you know? But we'll talk about that, but it wasn't as bad as I remembered it. So it said.
Okay. So I've read bits and pieces of it. I've seen bits and pieces of it online. I can't remember whose book or which book. I know there was maybe some pages in it, but as a filmmaker and as a guy who knows film, I mean, what would you have called, I guess, the genre of this movie? Would this be like kind of a Bob Hope-like romp from back in the day, a travelogue sort of thing?
Yeah, it's funny you say that because I've never – seen any of those Bob Hope, Bing Crosby Road movies.
That's what I was looking for, Road movie.
Yeah, the closest probably I could say I've gotten to seeing one of those is I know the Chevy Chase, Dan Aykroyd movie, Spies Like Us, is often compared to those movies. But what I know of those movies, it definitely sounds like this is probably that. It's just, it's very episodic. It's really just a vehicle for gags and jokes. It's very Borscht Belty, very Catskills, very shticky, you know. You know, there's no real, there's really no plot. I mean, we can dive into this, you know. I don't know what, you, if you guys want to just get right into it. I mean, there's really no plot. And it's funny because if you really, if you read it, and Dave's character, I mean, he's, you know, obviously he's supposed to be the main character, but there's really, like, there's really no journey. There's no quest they're on. There's no real goal. You know, like, I remember, I don't know if it was back in the day or if it was a later interview, I remember somebody asking Dave about this movie after it was obvious it wasn't going to happen. And they asked him if it was going to be like Pee-wee's Big Adventure. And I remember his response was, you know, it's not going to be like Pee-wee's Big Anything. And, you know, it's funny because it is somewhat like that in that Pee-wee's Big Adventure is very episodic, mm-hmm. but there's a goal. You know, he's trying to get his bicycle back. This movie, there's no goal, you know, they're just kind of wandering through the scenery, kind of, you know what I mean?
Sounds yeah. like maybe 200 Motels.
Yeah, I've seen that Zappa movie, right? Yeah.
So, yeah, we're 200 Motels. You're kind of grabbed into it because you're like, I like Zappa. Oh, Ringo Starr. Oh, Keith Moon. I'm really going to watch this. And you go, did anything happen in this whole film? I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's quite a bit like this. But instead of Ringo Starr and stuff, you get, is that the guy from the California Girls video? You know?
Steve, so I vaguely remember way back that there was some rumors pre-internet that some of this was filmed. We know nothing was filmed, correct? I mean, this was, did he have an actual deal with, if I remember correctly, yeah. CBS Pictures, and CBS Pictures went belly up.
Yeah, it was CBS Films. They made a couple of movies in like the mid 80s, and that's who he had the deal with. They did that whole big, you know, open casting call for, you know, people, you know, I think Dave's line at the time was like, we're looking for interesting faces, interesting bodies, interesting whatever. And I don't know if that might have just been like a publicity thing. I don't know if that was really a legit open casting call. But they did that. I mean, and from what I understand, maybe it's in his book, but from what I understand, they were very close to starting production when CBS Films pulled the plug. You know, and which resulted in a lawsuit, which whatever the result of that was. But I think they were very, very close. But yeah, I don't believe anything was shot. But I think that when CBS pulled the plug, it was like, you know, within a matter of like, you know, they were getting ready to start in a week or 2 weeks or something like that.
My question, see, Steve's questions are more, Steve One, we'll call him. His questions are generally more thought out and well researched. And my questions are, for better or for worse, shoot from the hip. So my question here is, I was one of the lucky media people in 2000 or 2001, whatever it was, that got one of those, actually two copies of the VHS tape of No Holds Barbecue, which you can now find on YouTube. Do people know by another name, No Holds Barbecue, or is it just the video from the Mojo Dojo, whatever you want to call it? It's basically him and other people, where nothing really happens. He's just kind of the center of action, and he breaks into song a bunch of times. Is there any chance that any of the Crazy from the Heat script wound up in that No Holds Barbecue concept or video?
I don't think so. I've never sat and watched that tape. I don't know that I could anymore. In 1988, I could have, but, you know, but I don't think so. But I do think that probably the spirit of the No Holds Barbecued is very similar to the spirit of the Crazy from the Heat script. The Crazy from the Heat script, as much as it has no plot or anything, it's probably a bit more focused than that. And that may be due to Pete Angelus's involvement. And also they wrote that script with a writer named Jerry Perzingia, I believe is his name. He's a sitcom writer. Jefferson's, Married with Children, Frasier, Golden Girls. He probably was brought in by those two guys to kind of help them write the script as far as like doing the actual writing. You know, I would imagine they would sit in a room, the three of them, and hash stuff out and talk about stuff. And Jerry would probably be the guy who went home and typed it all up. And that might be why the script has, as much of it has no plot, it's probably a bit more focused than you leave Dave to his own, you're going to get no holds barbecue. You bring in Jerry and Pete, you get Crazy from the Heat. You know what I mean?
Well, it's funny, Darren, you mentioned that no holds barbecue, because what I wondered was, I wondered if Crazy from the Heat, some of the characters from the Yankee Rose video was a logical extension from Crazy from the Heat. Like, maybe there could have been a guy with a hairnet in a convenience store. Maybe there could be a very large woman who trips on a heel and said, my doctor said I need to take a laxative. You know, that's what, so when I knowing that Crazy from the Heat was coming, I'm like, well, this is a bawdy and wacky bunch of characters. And then when you see the video for Going Crazy, where Dave and Pete Angelus are dressed up as, you know, two crazy ass moguls doing what was essentially, reminded me, they were kind of ahead of their time from the Jerky Boys when you think of it.
Yeah. Well, the character that Pete played, his Picasso brother, appears in the Crazy from the Heat script. Dave's doesn't. I don't think they had that idea yet, because the Going Crazy video came later.
Yeah.
Same year, but later. But Pete Angelus's Picasso brother character appears very briefly in the script. And I think that when you're reading Crazy from the Heat, the movie script, there are obviously it was an extension of those videos, California Girls, Gigolo, to a degree, Hot for Teacher. And then, you know, the beginning of Yankee Rose and the, you know, parts of Going Crazy. It's all that. I mean, that's what Crazy from the Heat would have essentially looked like on a tropical island. But there are characters in the script where when I was reading it this time, I don't know if I read it the first time I read it, if I had these thoughts, but there's a character named Jose who owns this crappy hotel on this island they stay at called the Dongo Inn. When you read his description in the script, it sounds like it could have been the cashier guy at the beginning of the Yankee Rose video. Uh-huh. Like when I'm reading that, I'm like, that sounds like it was that dude. Then Dave's road manager is a character named Julius, and he has a wife named Darla. And at first I thought, like in the California Girls video, there's a guy who kind of looks a little pimpish with a woman trying to put on this lipstick. And when I was reading Crazy from the Heat this time, I was like, I wonder if that is what those characters would have looked like. But then there's this character that shows up later in the movie who is a pimp. His name's Lamar. He shows up for one brief moment for an exchange between him and Dave's assistant in the script, named Stu, who's kind of like a put upon kind of probably a nerdish kind of dude. And his description, I was like, well, that sort of sounds like the guy from the... So I think there are characters, like, it definitely was going to be of that world. I mean, you know, I'm not really into all those superhero movies, but if you're going to call it this David Lee Roth universe, it would have felt like, you know, you would have had this character from the California Girls video or Gigolo video. It all sounds like it all kind of would have taken place in that same kind of vibe or universe or what have you.
So to be... But,
go ahead.
I was going to say, to be clear, it's not a musical, correct?
There are a couple of musical. There's parts in the script where it specifically states, like, you know, Shy Boy is playing here. Then there's other parts where I guess some of that music hadn't been created yet. So Shy Boy, because that existed already, was the only one that they really could point out, like, this is going to be Shy Boy. The other times it mentions in the script, like, you know, an original piece of music by Dave is going to be here. The only other one that they mention specifically is That's Life. He sings that. So it kind of is a musical where Dave's music's playing, but there are, I guess two or three instances where Dave is actually singing, performing. There's where he sings That's Life near the end. And it's funny because in the script, it mentions that he plays like a fast paced, like a fast paced rock version of That's Life. And that's really the version that's on that Eat 'Em and Smile isn't, I wouldn't really call it a fast paced rock version of that at all. So I wonder if that was just a thought even before that existed. But he does have the, you know, the moment where he and Pete are sitting on the beach and sharing a joint and drinking, and they start hallucinating, and out of the water comes Dave as King Neptune, and he performs it's very brief mentioned in the script. It's just like Dave comes out, and there's, you know, he's as King Neptune, and he does a performance. And then afterwards, there's just like a wrap up bit to the, like, you know, this is great weed or something stupid like that. But I think if that, you know, if this movie had been made, I think that scene in specifically would have given people like your Sammy Hagar's and such great fodder for ribbing Dave. You know, I don't think he would have heard the end of that. Not that he would have given a crap, but.
You mentioned the music, and that's where this really gets interesting for me, and that is the timeline. So Van Halen toured basically all of the year 1984, right? But practically, I mean, the album came out early, New Year's Day or something like that, and they were on the road. So by 85, somewhere around 85, and I can't remember exactly, they break up. I think the announcement was April Fool's Day, actually, if I remember correctly.
That's kind of like the... I don't think it really happened that. I think there was something pretty recently where there was an article. Maybe Greg wrote it, but that's what everybody... things
right
was, but it really wasn't. It was a bit later, you know,
right? So
summer, but yeah.
Yeah. So the mystery is, I guess, and just a mystery to me at least, is the timeline of this. So he's out of Van Halen around 85. And so let's say mid 85, within the span of like 6 months, he writes a screenplay, inks a deal, starts on music. Well, early 86. Do you know what I mean? And so I'm like, I wonder when this started to germinate.
Well, I thought I remember that originally, I think when he was making the Crazy from the Heat album or EP,
right?
I think he and Pete must have been kind of brewing this idea, because if I remember correctly, he wanted to make a Van Halen movie. He wanted to make a kind of like a crazy comedy with starring those four guys. And in all honesty, I mean, I would have loved to have seen it. Those four guys are pretty funny dudes, you know? I mean, yeah. Alex is hysterical. Eddie can be very funny. Michael, you know, he's pretty good too as well. You know, I mean, you see some of that footage of that was shot that was never used for like the Jump video, that they used a little bit of it for the Panama video. It's on YouTube, just like that silent footage of them just doing like shenanigans backstage, you know? And I mean, it's funny, you know, and I would have loved to seen that. But I think that he was brewing that idea of those guys making a movie. And that may have been the germ of Crazy from the Heat. I mean, it might not have been worked out at all or anything like that. And then I guess when he split with those guys, I guess they decided, you know, that he decided, like, let's do this, you know, let's dive in and make this. Because the script that I have that I bought.
Mm-hmm.
The date, it's the revised shooting script, and it's dated January 6th, 1986.
Wow.
So, you know, I mean, and like I said, you know, I mean, I don't know what months he was working on the Eat 'Em and Smile album when he was recording that, but you know, I mean, I would imagine, I mean, obviously he needed a soundtrack, so they must have been working on some of that music at that point, but like I said, in the script, the only things that are mentioned by name are Shy Boy and That's Life. So I don't know.
You know. Which I have to cut in here. Shy Boy was written by Billy Sheehan,
right? Correct? Yeah. Right. And that his old band, didn't Talis, isn't that an old Talis song or something?
Yep. Yes.
Rearranged or something?
And Billy Sheehan is not on the debut EP before Eat 'Em and Smile.
Right.
So how is that song in the movie, yet he wasn't in Dave's band at the time?
Well, he must have been involved, because Crazy from the Heat, the album, came out in January 1985. So, like, that was a year before all this, you know? So, like, I would imagine he probably hooked up with Bill. If I remember correctly, wasn't Billy Sheehan the first one
in the band,
that Dave hired? So, my gut tells me that sometime over the summer of 1985, Dave and Billy kind of, like, Dave and Pete and Jerry were starting to work on this script, and Dave was like, all right, I'm at Van Halen's not an option now, so I need a band, and that he must have met up with Billy Sheehan sometime that summer to kind of start piecing it together. So yeah. I think if Billy Sheehan was involved that much earlier, then that's probably why Shy Boy is there. It mentioned in the script, and he knew he was going to do that on his record or whatever, or the soundtrack.
Well, that was some early movement for Billy Sheehan getting acclimated into the DLR world. If there's that script and that song is in the script before we even know about Eat 'Em and Smile.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I mean. I don't know. Like in January 1986, they must have been working on some music and stuff. I mean, that band must have been, because, I mean, to have, if the script's January 86 and they're still thinking they're making this movie and they need a soundtrack and they need these guys to make music. Yeah. And Eat 'Em and Smile comes out in July. I mean, you know, it obviously must have been kind of brewing at that point too, you know?
Yeah. I mean, imagine if I recall, it was, the album essentially was recorded pretty quick. I mean, it's 10 Templemen, it's recorded live. The band is dead on tight. They were, they were together for, I think, at least a month beforehand. So, I mean, it's conceivable. It's just, when you think of it, if you looked at it from the outside, Van Halen's doing nothing for most of the year. There's no noise or no news, and the Crazy from the Heat EP comes out, and that's it, right? I mean, and Van Halen's inactive, and there's no announcement that he leaves. So it's like, but behind the scenes, this guy's the busiest guy in freaking rock and roll, pivoting on a dime. Well, all right, the movie's gone. Let's do an album.
Yeah,
and a tour.
Yeah, and I mean, I think at that time it was probably. It was probably like the peak for him as far as like, being kind of like, career minded or whatever, because I mean, after coming off of 1984 and, he just really became, I mean, they, Van Halen were big before 1984, but 1984 really, I think because of MTV and the videos and stuff, it really kind of put, especially Dave's persona. Like, I mean, you couldn't turn your head without seeing him somewhere talking and everything. So, I mean,
it got him out of the realm of just a rock singer to between the Jump video and everything, to a global superstar, him and the band, but especially him, because he was the front man and doing 90% of the press.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I think that, and obviously, he was younger. He was in like his early 30s maybe, so it was just, all right, Van Halen, that's not going to happen, we've got this idea to make this film, let's start working on the film, and certainly when you're younger, I mean, you can kind of, it's those ideas come to you a lot quicker, and you just kind of, or you have more of them, especially somebody like him with ADD, I can imagine it seems to us looking back at it like, wow, that came together really quick. But at the time, it probably didn't seem, it just probably seemed like business as usual for that dude,
As he told me in that 2004 interview, he hasn't slept since the 80s. but actually, what we've talked about here actually brings me to wonder something here. So the last Van Halen video with Dave in the 84 era was Hot for the Teacher, correct?
Right.
And then the next two videos off the Crazy from the Heat EP, he also had the spoken intros. And then the next two videos, Going Crazy and Yankee Rose, he had the spoken intros. And then we don't get any of those off the Skyscraper music videos, correct?
Yeah, it's weird, because I mean, even with the Crazy from, or the Eat 'Em and Smile videos, it's like he did that like comedic stuff. But they were, Yankee Rose was really more about performance. Like, I want to show this band off, I want to try to show up Van Halen. I want to show these guys off. And even, and Crazy, and Going Crazy was the same way. Like, he had the little comedy stuff that he and Pete brewed up, kind of interspersed, they did a little intro, but it was interspersed a little bit here and there, but it was still a performance video, and then Skyscraper, he just kind of ditched all that. I don't know. When he and Pete, I mean, I think he and Pete kind of parted ways maybe in 90, 92 or 93, maybe, because I remember buying the crate. I collect Van Halen and Dave stuff. Yes. And I remember in the early 90s, one of the things that I was really trying to hunt down was a CD copy of Crazy from the Heat. It wasn't released in the United States, but I was at a record show, and it turned out the one guy I was talking to there, you guys might enjoy this. I'm not a Kiss fan, but I used to collect this Van Halen stuff. I'd go to Kiss conventions. You remember these Kiss conventions?
Oh, yeah.
And I would go to them because I knew the vendors would have Van Halen stuff and Dave stuff. And I used to drag my girlfriend to it. She used to probably hate it. But, you know, somebody had to hold the records. No, but, but I would go to them. And it was great because they would always have like a guest from involved with Kiss somehow.
Yeah.
And whenever that person was going to be in this room talking, everybody would flock to it and I'd have the whole place to myself and I'd go digging through the records. But this guy he told me that Crazy from the Heat, it was released in Japan. There's a CD in Japan and he could get it for me and I got it. And then lo and behold, like a year later, Warner Brothers releases it in America. So I was like, I spent like $25 getting the CD from Japan. And a year later, I can get it, you know, for $10.98 or whatever in the United States. But my point is that on the Crazy from the Heat CD, you know, with the logos at the bottom, Warner Brothers and all that stuff, it said Angelus Entertainment.
Mm-hmm.
So he was still with Pete around 92 or whatever that was, but that must have been right around when those guys parted ways. I don't know why you don't get, you know, I mean, I guess he tried to do it. I don't know if Pete and Angelus was involved with the Little Ain't Enough video, because that's probably the closest video wise he came to like those early videos, like that same kind of vibe or whatever, you know?
Right.
But go ahead.
Yeah. So what I'm getting at is, you wonder if the fact that he didn't get to make that movie, if these Eat 'Em and Smile music videos was the creative release for that, where he goes, well, I didn't get to do a film. Let's make a bunch of mini films. And that was the direction. But then the Skyscraper videos are a little more serious. Yeah, he's smiling and joking around per se, but it was Heartthrob Dave was in effect for the title track and Just Like Paradise.
Yeah. He ditched the comedy. I don't know that's the thing is like, I don't know that guy, things like this really bother him or influence his decisions because, you know, the Just a Gigolo video is great. I'm not a fan of the song, never have been, but it's a great video. But that video, more so than California Girls or anything else, has kind of, you know, that's the Dave persona. Like that persona has essentially followed him for the rest of his career. When people think of Dave, they always think of the mosey, you know what I mean? And so I don't know if maybe, and again, I don't know that this guy really thinks this way, but, you know, I wonder if part of it was like, you know, people think I'm a buffoon, you know, let me try to remind them that I was a rock star, you know what I mean? And so let's concentrate on performance and stuff like that. I don't know, but it is odd that he kind of ditched, you know, that whole comedy kind of, you know, cause they were funny, you know, those two guys came up with some funny little videos, you know?
Sorry, Steve, it's back to the Steve One show after this.
No.
Another possibility is MTV going, hey, by the way, no more music videos over 3 minutes, 45 seconds. And then that was just kind of the barrier. And that. So back to you, Steve One.
Now, I was going to say, Steve, you got me thinking of something you said. And that is what you this would have made perfect sense had it been maybe 30 years before, because Dave, had he was born in another era, he would have been in the Catskills, a Borscht Belt guy doing these kind of movies. I mean, you know, when I look at that Just a Gigolo video and like, you know, that, you know, mosey bop, that whole thing. I mean, and we know his passion for vaudeville and all that stuff. I mean, it, you know, he was 30 it could have been a much different story. I could, you know, now what we know about the movie, he was either ahead of his time or a man out of his time during that time. You know what
yeah.
I mean?
Yeah, it's interesting because like when you read the script, the instantly, I can't help but like read the script and wonder like had this movie been made, like I don't think it would have been very successful. I don't think it would have been a big hit at the box office. I think you would have had his fans probably would have shown up. I think on video, people probably, you know, at parties getting drunk or high might have popped it in for some laughs.
Yeah.
You know, but I don't think it would have been very successful, you know. But I can't help but like wonder, like, you know, how would this thing have aged? There's a couple of jokes in it that certainly are off, you know, way off limits now involving young girls. But you know, like I can't help but wonder, like, how would this thing have aged? I mean, I don't doubt for a minute, you know, that it would have been highlighted probably very early on that podcast. How did this get made? You know, I'm sure this would have been one of their, like when those guys sat down to discuss, like, what film should we discuss? I don't doubt for a minute this would have been at the top of all their lists. But yeah, it's just an odd film, you know, and it's funny too, because early on reading it, like the first like portion of it, when I was reading it this time, I was like, well, you know, he'd be going for an R rating. Mm-hmm. But early on, it feels somewhat tame. You're like, this almost feels like PG-13. Nobody's cursing. There's no nudity. And then it sort of kind of veers off and you're like, all right, here we go. This is an R rating. You know
what I mean? Knowing what we know now, I think it might be safe to say, in hindsight, it's always 2020, but Dave career-wise dodged a real bullet by not having this movie come out when you think of it. I mean, it could have, distinctly remember, because I mean, I wasn't 12 years old then. I was, you know, 18, 19 years old. I remember distinctly thinking, God, this does not seem cool. You know what I mean? Yeah. And yeah. Of course, and that was colored by the fact of, you know, just the sheer shock and horror of, no, he left Van Halen, you know, what? But I mean, in the big picture, when you think of it, this could have been fodder for ridicule for a long, long time.
It definitely would. It's that's what I mean. It's hard to say. In that time, in 1986, this comes out. Like I said, I don't think it would have been a big hit, but you know, I mean, like I said, I think I said at the beginning, like 1986, me probably would have thought this was hysterical and probably would have thought it was one of the funniest movies that I'd seen, you know? Now I'd probably watch it and just be like, oh my goodness, you know, like what is it? But you know, it's a bizarre thing. And like I said, you know, it's just like bits. There's nothing, there's no journey he's on. It's like they, at the end, it feels like the character Jose, who I mentioned, sounded like it could have been the guy from the Yankee Rose video, the cashier. Like he owns the hotel and he, you know, when they're all parting, you know, he's like to Dave, he's like, you know, thanks, you know, like my hotel now is booked till the end of the century, you know, that's all because of the concert you did and everything. And but it's weird because it makes you feel like, oh, was this movie about him trying to save this rundown hotel in the tropics? But it's not. It just like comes out of nowhere. You know, it's like, oh, I didn't even know the place was in, you know, bad, you know, like in danger of closing or something. It's just this random thing. It's you know, there's a lot of the 80s in that. There are movies from the 80s that are, you know, the same kind of thing where it's just this, you know, random bits, all these characters running around and stuff, and there's really no plot, you know, and at the end of the movie everybody parts the islands like, thanks, you saved us, man, you know what I mean?
Well, okay, so I'm gonna take away my 200 Motels comparison and go, this just sounds like UHF.
yeah, a little bit. But even UHF, they were trying to save this station, you know what I mean? Like this, there's nothing like that. The closest thing to it is Dave's manager named Bernie owes these two like thug guys, mob kind of guys, money, and he's broke, Dave's manager, and the only thing that he has that he can think is worth something is that he's Dave's manager, and he basically like sells Dave's managerial position off to these guys. It's like he's like, you guys are his manager now, like he's worth millions, you guys are his manager now. And then they go to the island and see Dave and they're insulted by him. And then that kind of just is wrapped up in like 1 second, you know? So like the closest thing to like some kind of plot is it's not even Dave really. It's just Dave's manager, you know? But like I said, even that kind of comes in the end. And then Dave kind of gets his revenge on the manager. But it's such a like, you know, a side kind of story, you know, it really is not driving the movie. So, and I mean, it sounds ridiculous to be kind of like looking for, you know, like what, you know, what's Dave's character motivations and stuff in a David Lee Roth comedy circa 1986, you know, but it really, there really is like, no, like, you know, like I, like you brought up UHF, like even that you could say like, oh, it's just all these bits and stuff. But at the heart of it, he's trying to save this TV station. And this, like, it's like nothing. It's just like nothing going on. It's just Dave kind of going by. Like, even when they, like, they're trying to get to this resort that they were supposed to be going to, the Club Tropico, and they don't make it there. They get hung up. They get, surrounded by cannibals. And obviously when I'm reading, I'm like, oh, I wonder if they would have looked like the cover of Eat 'Em and Smile. Yeah. But you know, they get kind of sidetracked with these cannibals, and of course the chief knows Dave and blah 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 happens, and you know, there's no like real like we gotta get to that resort. They're just like, all right, then they show up at this other, you know, hotel, the Dongo Inn or whatever, and Dave's like, this is my place, you know what I mean? It's just like, it's not like we gotta get to the we're still not at Club Tropico. No, it's just like wherever he is, that's where he wants to be, you know? It's like there's no like journey, there's no conflict or anything, you know? It's just like, hey, these are my people, I want to stay here. It's like, it's a rundown hotel, ah, this is perfect, you know? And it's just an odd movie. But I mean, knowing, you know, his persona or whatever, I mean, it completely fits it, you know?
I get the vibe that he would have played 6 characters in this movie. You imagine him coming out of the water after smoking a J. You mentioned the tribal people coming out of the forest, and we know what the album cover of Edelman's Smile was. We know that he would have had a fake mustache in a scene. He would have been the bartender with an accent. That's my one regret of this not being made, seeing the characters.
There's nothing in the script that specifically makes you think that, like the Pete Angelus Picasso part. Because like right after Pete Angelus Picasso brother shows up, then like Dave turns to Pete. So it was obvious. It was like, oh, there's Pete playing this guy, and now he's playing himself, you know? I don't doubt that you're absolutely correct. Having, knowing that we've seen Dave in some of those videos play these other characters, you know, I don't doubt that he probably would have, you know, been all about like doing something. And the script at the same time, the script does, he does take, you know, a couple of shots at himself, you know, one character mentions, I think his manager mentions that Dave can't sing, you know, his road manager has kind of a funny line where, you know, Dave's like, oh, can you get me, it's like out of the Blues Brothers. He's like, he wants to make an announcement. He's going to perform at the Dongo Inn. So can you get me on the local radio station? I just need 5 minutes. And the guy's like, I've never heard you say anything in 5 minutes. You know what I mean? Like, you know, so, you know, there's some kind of funny little bits, and he kind of takes a couple of little digs at himself, you know, here and there. But yeah, I don't doubt he probably would have played a couple of different characters, I would imagine.
It sounds like this needs one of those Upright Citizens Brigade script reading things where you have, there's Donald Glover as David Lee Roth. And
that would be awesome.
Well, I thought that's what we were going to do today, man.
That'll be another episode.
He was going to play Bernie, and you were going to play Mario, the owner of the Whiskey and the Rainbow. He shows up for one little scene, you know, and yeah, it's kind of, it's, you know, it's quite a little, you know, script there. I mean, it's just, you know, it's like I said before, I in recent times, I would always tell people like, oh, he dodged a bullet. This is horrible, because I hadn't read it since 1990. When I read it now, I mean, there's some funny bits in there, you know, I mean, there are a couple, as kind of shticky as they are, there's some funny stuff. The one thing when I was reading it, though, it did feel like, and I don't know if this would have been true in 1986, but a lot of it felt very familiar. Like a lot of the jokes and the setups, it's like you can see where they're going a mile away, you know, like, you know, it's just like, oh, okay, I know where this joke's going and stuff. There's a lot of that where you can just like see that stuff coming a mile away. And again, like I said, I don't know if that's just because the years have passed. We've seen other versions of those jokes and stuff like that, or they're just very familiar. But yes, it's a bizarre thing.
So in other words, 2 years after it flopped in the theaters, when you see it on regular TV, and the TV guide description, if anybody remembers TV guide, which I know we do, the description would have been, in this broad comic romp, former Van Halen singer David Lee Roth, ..
Or either that, or it would have just been like, to each their own, .. You know, go into this, like, you know, go into this with this warning. You know what I mean? Yeah. No, it definitely would have. I mean, obviously, like we said before, I mean, the Van Halen guys would have just shredded this thing, man. I mean, you know, they kind of did without the movie even happening. I mean, their, you know, go-to, like, soundbite was always, like, they wanted to be a movie star.
Right,
you know?
Right.
You know? And it's odd because when they, you guys might have talked about this on an episode, but it's funny that, you know, it's funny to me that he's never really, nobody's ever really cast him in anything. Like, he showed up on that Sopranos episode and stuff. But it's surprising to me that nobody's ever, like, you know, cast him just to, like, appear and just, like, some little one scene. Like, we want you to play a used car salesman in this movie, you know, just pop up. It's odd to me that he's never done any of that stuff, you know, and especially because, not that I believed it, but because those guys just hammered that idea home, like, Dave wanted to be a movie star, Dave wanted to be a movie star, you know, and he's never done anything really, you know.
I would not be surprised. I would bet that maybe he got some offers in during that heady, like, 84 to 86 time period. But for whatever reason, maybe it was bad, or, you know, the fact that he turned down being in front of a camera, if that's the case. But I've often wondered that same as you have, Steve. I often wonder that. It's like, because the time period just seems so natural.
Somebody commented on our last episode on YouTube and said that Dave auditioned for the father role in Walk the Line, which I don't know if they were joking or they knew someone who knew something there.
Yeah. You mean Walk the Line, or do you mean Walk Hard?
Walk Hard. I love Walk Hard.
Walk the Line? The Johnny Cash movie? Oh, yeah. Really? Yeah, I don't know. You know, and not for nothing. I mean, you know, I don't doubt that the guy has got that in him to give a good dramatic performance. You know, I mean, we think of him as like a goof and what have you and joking around a lot. But you know, I think the guy probably could, if he, you know, he probably could give a really good dramatic performance if given the opportunity. I wouldn't doubt that, you know. You know, kind of calling back to something you mentioned earlier, there is a moment in this script where Dave gets to do like a whole kung fu scene where he's beating up these two guys. I think it's the two thugs that his manager pawned off his manager contract off on or something, but there's a whole thing, which obviously would have been some sort of like kind of Bruce Lee parody or what have you. But you know, he gets to do his kung fu or whatever.
Which is a predecessor to his Yakuza movie from Japan, which started off this whole conversation right there. Exactly. So I resent the fact that you guys don't consider that acting, because he shouts in Japanese at some thugs That's some serious stuff.
Yeah.
Nah. And this smoldering performance, former Van Halen singer David Lee Roth.
Be glad it's only 10 minutes long, you know.
Has anyone ever heard, was that supposed to be part of like a feature length, for example, that was supposed to be a sizzle reel EPK kind of thing?
I don't know. Maybe. I mean, he's hard to figure out because, I mean, you guys, I'm sure, have talked about this multiple times. It's just, we know he's got that, you know, ADD, and he's just kind of like got his hands doing a million things at once. I mean, I heard just recently you guys were talking a little bit about that tattoo ink company, the tattoo stuff, or whatever, and, you know, how he doesn't even mention it anymore. It just seems to me like it's one of those things. It's just like his, you know, attention span is so short that it's like he's all into it for a month or so, and then he's forgotten all about it. And I don't doubt that Yakuza thing or whatever video, it was just something that he did over there, and it was just like, you know, here's something to do while he's there. He shot it and then that was it, or he shopped it around, nobody was interested, and he's just like, all right, next, move on, you know, and move on to something else, you know. Or I don't know, but it just seems that he's that way. It's just like he's all into something for a minute or two and then he's just moves on to something else, you know. It's not, you know,
how else can a world famous rock star become an EMT?
Yeah, exactly. You know,
you just go all in.
Yeah.
And on to the next thing.
If I put you guys on mute for 2 minutes, I'll come back with the information as to whether or not Ink the Original is still in business with the state of California. If you can vamp for about 2 minutes, stand by.
Well, I'll tell you, here's what I was thinking. There's a way to resurrect this, and that is an animated series. This makes so perfect sense. Dave doing all the animation and, you know, all the ink work on it.
Yeah. No, that would be... I thought you were going to say like an animated thing, like Dave, like a cartoon Dave, like running around like the old like Jackson 5 cartoon or whatever. I was like, Lord knows what that would be. But I don't know. It's just bizarre. I mean, I think a lot of it maybe is just that attention span. He just, you know, I mean, he just doesn't seem like he could really, you know, stay interested in something like that too long, you know, like to do something like that. Like especially if it's something you got to kind of like work to kind of put together. If he does like this Yakuza thing and it's like, oh, people are interested in making it, then I think he could be like all in. But, you know, if people just aren't biting and he just, it's not like he's like, well, I'm going to work, you know, like us indie filmmakers, it's like, hey, we're going to struggle. It's going to take us years to get this made, whatever. I don't think he operates that way. It's like, if he puts it out there, if people aren't interested, then he's just on to the next thing, you know?
Yeah, Matt, we've speculated that a lot. It's tough to keep track, and then stuff will just kind of, you know, mercifully, the music for the most part never really disappeared. I mean, that's always was number one because, you know, there was times where, well, like we're all talking about, it's like, oh, is he going to quit music and do movies, you know? And then
it's a perfect example is like all those, he's got all these songs, like he just would go into like Henson Studios and just record songs just on his own dime, just for the hell of it, you know. And some of those came out on that Diamond Dave record, but we know that there's troves of other tunes like that that, you know, it's just, I don't, you know, he's just doing it because I guess he feels like doing it, you know. It's not really about like a project necessarily or whatever. And, you know, because I remember reading about the Ice Cream, the big band version of Ice Cream Man he did in his book, and then then finally it came out. I think it's on that Diamond Dave record, you know, but, you know, I mean, obviously it was just like, you know, I remember people just saying like, yeah, he put like $1 million of his own, shot this. And there's stills maybe in the book of him just fumbling around in the studio or whatever and stuff. And and it's just odd, you know, that they just kind of, you know, he just does those kind of things. You know, Steve, real quick, No Big Thing. I'll give you that it's not a good song, but the lyrics in that are great.
The lyrics
I've always loved in that song. I've always loved the lyrics in that song. And so, like, you know, I put it on my like iPhone, and if it comes up playing in the car, like, sure, I might want to turn it down a little bit, but I love that some of the lyrics in that song are just, I think, some of the best stuff he's written. You know,
I can't fault the lyrics. I absolutely love the lyrics in every song on Your Filthy Little Mouth.
It's some of his best writing lyric wise.
And I think that album still has not gotten its just due. Cause I love the album, but it's just a couple songs where it's like, all right, you're reaching a little bit. Cheating Heart Cafe. Love the lyrics, you know, and No Big Thing musically, but the rest of it, I'll tell you, that record I loved from the very beginning. And I just, from the first time I heard it, and I just thought, you know, I can quibble with the sound of it. I mean, I wish that had, I don't know if, I just don't think Nile Rodgers and him really fit together. It's just an odd sounding record. You know, it's like, where's the rhythm section in that record? You know what I mean? It's just, but as albums go, I love it. And you're absolutely right on the lyrics.
Yeah. I always thought that was good. And, so, Ink the Original.
It's not in business as Ink the Original. It's under his LLC, which he always says the name of. And he changed managers of it about 2 years ago. He's due to file another statement in the next month or so. How do you know this, Darren? I'm a licensed PI. I don't know. I knew where to look for this kind of stuff, but it's in business under basically a shell company that he could be getting other royalties or other stuff through. So it's not clear if it exists, but his lawyer is on LinkedIn who signed
this new statement. Well, that's the thing. It's like he's never, I don't think he's ever going to be one of those guys like Hagar or Michael Anthony with his hot sauce or who is Joe Perry. Doesn't he have hot sauce or something?
He does.
Like, he's never going to be one of those guys. He's like, this is my product. I'm going to shill this thing until the end of time. Like Dave, it's just like, hey, I got this stuff for your tattoos. And then like a month later, you know, you guys are going like, does that even exist anymore? You know, yes. It's like, it's just the way he operates, I guess, you know?
Well, that's the funny thing when you compare that to all those other products, right? I mean, their names are all a part of that for the most part, but this could have easily been David Lee Ross, Inc. You know what I mean? And yeah, it just wasn't, but that was the mystery. 'Cause it was 2 years ago. It was like, wow, okay, man, he's getting written up everywhere and there's press on this. And, you know, you hear about how much money sunk into it. And then it's like, it's, you know, sounds like a great idea for a product. And then what happened?
Well, it's kind of, in a way, bringing it back to the script. It's probably in the same way why after 1986, he's going to make this movie. It's about to start. They're all ready to go. They've hired the whole crew, the cast. Then CBS pulls the plug on it. He goes to, you know, the courts with them, blah, gets settled, whatever happens.
Yeah.
Then he just gives up on it. It's not like a year later, he's like, all right, well, we're going to, you know, try to find another company to finance this or bring it to somebody else. It's just, that's it. Moving on to something else, you know?
The great producer and writer Norman Lear says his whole theory for success and for failure is something he calls over and next. When it's over, and then you're on to the next thing.
Sure.
And if you have the means and the wherewithal to do just about anything you want to do, God bless you. Why don't you go ahead and do it?
I wish I could live that lifestyle. Yeah, he's like living like people like, why is he in Japan? I'm like, if I could do that, I'd be living in Japan for a couple months too. Like, yeah, like what are you crazy?
Why is he in Japan with an Iron Man mask on the subway? With his dog. What does that mean? It doesn't mean anything. Like, it's Dave.
Yeah. It's like you go, I think I was in like Thailand or something, man. And it's just like, you know, everywhere you go, it's just like, why not? You know, like, why am I going to do that? Why not? You know, why not? Why not? Yeah. Why not do that? You know?
So putting that all together, though, it sounds like this is a guy who has it all figured out in terms of not looking back and no regrets. He wants to do something, he does it, and then he moves on to the next thing. And you guys just called that, like, the script didn't happen, he moved on. The radio thing, that was a bust. He didn't look for a new radio deal. He got his settlement after suing.
These stories end with him in court somehow.
So for all we know, he's like, well, Ink the Original didn't work. Next, what am I going to do next?
Yeah, pretty much. It sounds like it, you know. I mean, that seems to be the way he's kind of operated for a long time now, you know. Just like moves on to the next thing, you know. It's odd.
I'm waiting for the artwork to just stop, of which it seems to be slowing down a bit. It's just okay. All right. Well, I'm hoping for another song to pop up an hour from now or 3 months from now. You never know.
Who knows? It's funny that like you have some artists like that who, you know, are still about putting out music or whatever, and then you have these other guys who just kind of seem like they just kind of feel like that ship has sailed. Like, you know, they'll make these songs or whatever, but like the idea of putting out a record, it just seems like there's just no point. You know, why bother? You know, like nobody's. It's not, you know, people aren't that interested, you know.
And that's the mystery to me, because this is the complete opposite of Dave, where, you know, I don't know how you can, if you have that kind of creative bent to you, I don't know how you ever stop creating, right? It's like whether it comes to music or whatever. And I think for Dave's, you know, in Dave's instance, he's creating something all the time. It just, you know, it's not going to be the normal convention or what people expect from him.
Yeah. And I mean, that's great. I mean, the stuff he does, that artwork, some of it's really phenomenal, you know? And I mean, like, I think we all kind of know he seems to live a pretty kind of, for lack of a better term, kind of lonely existence, maybe, you know?
Nomadic?
I mean, he doesn't. Well, you know, I mean, he, yeah, exactly. I mean, it seems like he probably spends a lot of time alone. and sitting down and drawing, you know, that entertains, he's entertaining himself. It's something that he enjoys doing, you know, and he's very good at it, you know? So, I mean, I could see where that's how he fills his time, just sitting there drawing, painting, whatever. If he has the urge to be around some people, he goes to the strip club, you know, seems to be the way he operates, you know, but yeah,
for better, for worse, maybe he has to figure it out and we don't.
Yeah, you never know. But yeah, but it's an interesting script to read. I know it's out there. It's, if you're a fan, I think it's worth kind of thumbing through. I mean, I don't know how many people are going to really get through the whole script reading it, but it's an interesting sort of like relic, you know, from that time period. Like, you know, I mean, it's very seeped in the 80s and, you know, that whole persona, that Diamond Dave persona, you know. Surprisingly, somebody only calls him Diamond Dave, I think, once, you know, in the whole movie. But you know, there are some funny bits in it.
Wow. Well, I'm out of questions. Steve Wan, are you out of questions?
This has been a blast, Steve. I'll tell you, I learned a lot, and I love talking about this stuff. And I think we're going to have you back and maybe take a deep dive into your Filthy Little Mouth record or some other point of fandom that we're all into.
Yeah, no, it'd be great. I'm glad I got to talk to you guys. I enjoy the podcast quite a bit, and it's, you know, it's always fun talking to some fellow fans, you know, of that crazy band that we follow and have been fans of, you know.
Exactly. Right. What's the best place to find you on the web so we know when Joint Films is doing its thing?
Yeah, jointfilms.com. You can get to everything through that. You know, we're working on a new film right now. Next weekend, we're shooting some stuff. So pray for sunny weather for us, because it's all exteriors. So, you know, you got to hope that Mother Nature cooperates.
We'll pray for sunny weather, but for them to not be crazy from the.
That's why you get paid the big bucks, right? That's why you make more than Steve, right?
Pull that in my most favorite nations clause, you know, both of those things. You know, Steve likes to party. I am the party.
There's a, you know, not to kind of drag this on anymore, but that joke comes up in the script. He says, we're having a party. A version of that. He says, oh, Dave, what are we having a party here? He's like, nah, I can't take credit for that. I just bring the guest list, you know, because he shows up with like 1,000 people or what have you. Really quick, the interesting thing would have been, if he had made the film, would Steve Vai and Billy Sheehan and Greg Bissonette appeared? Because there is one scene near the end, I think they go to a strip club, and he mentions in the script that there's two guitarists on stage with this girl while she's stripping. And when I read that, I instantly was like, oh, I wonder if, you know, Steve Vai and Billy Sheehan were going to, like, that was like his opportunity to kind of get them into the film or something like that. But yeah, anyways. Yeah,
two guitarists. It could have been Steve Vai and Ralph Macchio.
Well, yeah. That would have drove a lot of people into the theaters, I'm sure. Crossroads.
Crossroads, exactly. Doesn't hold up, but what can you do? Thank you.
Guys, it's been great. I really enjoyed this. You know, it's been a pleasure talking to you both.
Nothing but yeah. Thanks, Steve.
Thanks, Steve.
All right, have a good one.